Good afternoon, everyone. Ali Corman, Ed Carson here with a look at the stock market today and how the week went down. And Ed, it was quite a roller coaster of a week.
Yeah, it was a lot of roller coaster day by day, intraday. I'm going to take a look at one stock that was definitely a roller coaster, Nucor. One that was fairly steady, CubeSmart, and then Microsoft, a long-term leader that is starting to come under pressure as well.
Okay, we'll do that. But first, let's take a look at the major indexes. And since it's Friday, we'll kick things off with a look at Thinkorswim from TD Ameritrade. So here's the NASDAQ composite, finishing the day down about 0.1%. We also had the S&P 500 down 1%. The Dow down 1.5%, and the Russell 2000, so small caps in the green today by about 0.8%. So we came very close to the danger zone today, Ed. If we were to have closed below the follow-through day on Wednesday, so we did not do that, but that doesn't mean that what went down Thursday and Friday was encouraging by any means.
No, and let's just go through the week. I mean, we started off, you know, we started off on Monday. We came, you know, we sort of came down. We closed fairly poorly on Tuesday. Yeah, we closed okay, but we broke through the 50-day line. I mean, closed okay. It's like just from that range, but the true range wasn't that good because you can see that gap down. On Wednesday, not a great start. Then we had sort of an expectation breaker. Wow, powerful rally on a hawkish Fed and nice rebound. So that was sort of a green light back above the 50-day line. You know, I think it got to the 21-day line. Nice action there. But then we
and a follow-through day.
And a follow-through day, which means that's a confirmed rally, a strong signal that institutions are supporting this rally. There were some leading stocks showed some nice moves like AMD, NVIDIA. So there's a lot of reasons to be positive. And then on Thursday, especially on the NASDAQ, it all came just right back down, wiped out all of Wednesday's gains, didn't get below the low, but really negative. Not as bad that, you know, the Dow was basically flat, but now we just changed gears on Friday. Now the Dow has sold off more and the NASDAQ was basically flat. You know, if we had closed below Wednesday's low, the full follow through day, that is a sum of like almost like 90%. I saw one statistic we were talking about on IBD Live. There's a 90% chance that the rally will fail if you close below the Wednesday low. So we didn't get there. We undercut the low intraday, didn't get there. If we close below that low, boy, that's awfully close to the rally low. That would be the official killing of the rally, at least on the NASDAQ. And we got to within 30 points of undercutting that. So we came very, very close from doing that. So it's around, but it's a little bit like a boxer that just took a bunch of punches and is just sort of like reeling up there. It's like, well, he's still standing, but, you know, doesn't look too good.
Yeah, it doesn't. And let's take a look at this on a weekly chart as well. So we have a big red bar here. And yeah, a couple of weeks now that we've tested the lows from kind of right around the same area. But now let's take a look at the S&P 500, which you mentioned. So this is now on MarketSmith here. So the S&P coming down to its 50-day line on Friday and testing support at that level. And again, down about 1% for the day and closing just above this 4,600 level.
Yeah, found support at the 50-day line, but it's testing that. It undercut, you know, the follow-through day as well, because it was a follow-through on the S&P and the NASDAQ. But didn't close below it, but not really positive here. There's a lot of negatives today. You know, energy and financial stocks had rough sessions. So yeah, trouble here as well.
Okay. And the Dow, as you said, so it, not only do we have all of this volatility, but it's different day to day, which groups are getting hit the hardest. It's hard for me to even talk about because it's hard to wrap your mind around each day, which group is going to be holding up. Tech a little bit better today, but underneath the surface, a lot of rotation, and we have the Dow down below its 50-day line.
Yeah, and I guess that closed just may have closed. I'm not sure where it closed exactly, if that closed above or below the official close, because I'm not sure if we're there yet. But it technically isn't a follow-through day low because the Dow didn't follow through. but it's still not a positive sign. Yeah, it is. It's so volatile, whipsaw the indexes, but then to have the stock sector rotation and in between all that, it's really hard to get any sense of conviction in anything right now.
Mm-hmm. And small caps, the strongest on Friday, but that doesn't really say a whole lot because of just how incredibly weak the Russell 2000 has been. So down about 2.2% for the week here. And so right around its lowest level still in quite a while, even though we did get a little bit of a bounce today.
Yeah, it's a 5-month low, even with that really, really steep decline. It's not breaking a trend line, that's for sure. I mean, so we just need to see a lot more strength. You know, we obviously have seen big one days, and when you're in a correction, big days, and obviously it was a follow through, but when you're in a downdraft, big days are not uncommon. What you want to see is that real momentum. We thought maybe we had it on Wednesday. You know, it's really a tough slog right now. It's really hard to do well in this market.
Mm-hmm. But as you were pointing out, Ed, you don't want to get too aggressive on the follow through day. And this shows why there's not 100% guarantee that a confirmed uptrend will work once you get that follow through day. So we're definitely still cautious about where we're at right now. And especially because of how growth stocks have been acting. So FFTY did manage a gain of about 0.25% on Friday, but just like the Russell 2000, I mean, what a steep decline FFTY, the ETF that tracks the IABD 50, has seen in the last number of weeks here. And Ed, getting hit by about 5.6% this week. So underperforming in a pretty big way.
Yeah, really, really sharp selling. And this is why it's like, you know, for a while there, we had the Apples and some of those keeping things going, but this and the Russell, there's the market breadth has been really weak there, even, which is why one reason why to be cautious about this follow through day, you know, it's just not a good situation. Most stocks are falling. I don't know how we did today, but this is through Thursday. We hit yet another low. And yeah, you can have these one days or 2 days where things look better, but the trend has been bad, certainly since early November, but arguably it's been sliding since even maybe, you know, certainly there. And that's just not a positive divergence. When you have that kind of divergence, it just eventually there is likely to be issues on the downside.
Mm-hmm. I mean, there is one school of thought that is saying, is this capitulation at this point? How much worse can it get in terms of breadth? But we'll let the indexes and the action among leading stocks be our guide. But let's also take a look at some of the sectors underneath the surface. So here is the XME Metals and Mining ETF, up 1.3% for the day. But this hasn't been a leading group in recent weeks. Could we potentially be seeing a turn?
Yeah, I mean, it's possible. But the problem is, do you want to be a leading group in a bad market? It's one thing if this market starts improving, then a leading group is fine. But it's hard to have much conviction. I mean, it shrugged off a Nucor warning. It, you know, really shrugged off another warning from a steelmaker today. So that was positive. But yeah, the relative strength has been weak. There's been a lot of false action in the past few months. And so I think investors should definitely be wary. I mean, if they want to step into it, know that there are definitely issues with this group.
Yeah. And speaking of false starts, let's take a look at XLF. So financials, we got a pretty positive signal from XLF on Thursday, trying to get back above its 50-day line, but financials slammed down again on Friday, down about 2.3%.
Yeah. And it's just like, you know, I can understand why people would have played this or played some other financials, and they just got hit really hard today. And that's just the difficulty in this market. So whipsaw. Every buy signal is almost just a way to lure people in. It's more like the old sirens. Oh, everything's fine. Let's go there. And then you get, you know, you just run right into the rocks.
Yeah. And one area is standing out, and that's healthcare. The XLV ETF did dip by about 0.7% on Friday, but a pretty strong week for XLV, up about 2.5%. So in terms of keeping your watch list fresh with stocks outperforming, seems like healthcare is a ripe place for that.
Yeah, you definitely want to. Some are extended, but you want to hold on to, you know, take a look at those, because especially if we have an extended week period, they could set up again. Others are setting up and doing well. So definitely a lot of stocks from a lot of medicals from a variety of groups. So yes, definitely one to be watching right now.
Okay. And you mentioned Nucor. So let's go there, Ed. Ticker NUE gained 3.7% on Friday, but what a wild week. So this is just, you know, one of the microcosms of what we've been seeing in the market. Just when Nucor was starting to look promising with a bounce off of its 50-day line, the stock getting hit on news pretty significantly with a close below the 50-day line, though off lows. It did shake that off by week's end, but this is just another tricky stock in a very tricky market.
Yeah, and it had a failed breakout a few weeks ago. I think the concern would be, you know, if we get up above 120, 122 and have a real breakout, is that going to be a place where we just roll over? I mean, that's been an issue with 2021 with a lot of stocks. But in this environment, with this kind of stock, that's just an issue. I mean, this one very well may work. On a weekly chart, it looks a little better because, you know, it closed near the high of its range. It doesn't look so whipsaw, but on a day-to-day basis, boy, oh boy, that's just really difficult.
Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, intraday, the stock was down, 10, 11, 12% below
least,
the 50,
I think, yeah.
At least, and below its lows from early December. So triggering a sell signal there. So that's one of the tough trades that we've seen this week. But elsewhere, let's take a look at an area that it helps, you know, our blood pressure a little bit, and that is REITs. So CubeSmart up 2.4% on Friday, some nice volume behind it. It's just working on this little flat base here, Ed, and you get a nice dividend with it. So that's a plus.
Yeah, it's like a 3% dividend. That's nice. There's some nice things about it. The growth has been accelerating a little bit. I don't, you know, some of that might be easier comparisons, but the growth is doing fine. So that's nice trend. I mean, I can imagine that slowing, but it still looks like it's pretty decent growth in 2022. So it's not like you're getting a no growth kind of, it's defensive, but it's not defensive. The relative strength line has improved. It's just been consolidating, but it's near highs, which makes sense given that the market hasn't been doing so well. Stocks that are basing are not seeing their RS lines fall. And yeah, I mean, normally you might have said this was almost an early entry or if it was flirting with it, you know, it's really hard. It's in this kind of environment. Do you want to go with any kind of thing? If you wait till the breakout, does that mean when it's going to roll over again? If you buy early, I mean, is that enough sign of a strength? Again, that's so hard to have conviction in this environment. There's sort of that area. If you get above the highs from a couple of weeks ago, there's sort of that area right around just above 56. So that would be areas. So that whole area is sort of an early, you know, kind of early entry. How this will do, I don't know. One thing is that if interest rates rise, especially the long-term rates, this won't fall apart necessarily, but it could go down because, you know, the yield will look less attractive to investors. So that will be a factor. So even though it's not, you know, it's been relatively steady now, and I will say it's held up pretty well despite some swings in the interest rates, but that is a concern, especially if there's a secular increase in those rates.
Good point there, Ed. And what do you think it says about the market that so many REITs have been popping up on our screens lately?
Yeah, it tells you, like, look, growth, we saw the growth stocks. I mean, they look terrible. In this environment, it's defensive. You know, it does not say great things. I mean, I will say they do have decent profits, so they're not no growth things, but yeah, this is not the typical stocks that we are looking at in a healthy bull market.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And let's also take a look at Microsoft, which is a long-term leader. It fell about 0.3% on Friday. So coming back from an earlier loss that was a little bigger, and taking a look at a weekly chart, this is a test of support at the 10-week line. So we can't say it's a rebound yet. It is a test that is in progress here for Microsoft. So we definitely want to see it hold the 10-week line.
Yeah, and it actually undercut the lows from a couple of weeks ago just for a moment, which, I mean, maybe you could say that's a great test, you know, and because it bounced off of that, but definitely a key area here. You know, if it bounced off the 50-day line, I think you'd want to get at least above Thursday's high to be before thinking about you know, that that would be actionable, because we talk about buying long-term leaders off the 50-day line, but it's so vertical. There's not, it would hard to be argue that. Also, I think just in general, if you, with a stock like this, if it got above Thursday's high, that's probably saying something about how the market is doing. Probably right. The NASDAQ is showing some strength. I'm not sure if it's enough strength, but maybe then the NASDAQ is getting above Thursday's highs or something. And that might be a little bit of a sense, but I mean, it's tricky. This is a key area. This has been a real leader. The RS line hasn't fallen that much. It fell 5% this week, and the RS line didn't fall that much, which is telling you something about how the market is when a 5% drop doesn't make a RS line tumble.
Yeah, seriously. Okay. And so then that's kind of the upside scenario. But even if we do get a positive signal, I mean, this market has been so volatile, we could get 3 more head fakes and, you know, really need our necks cracked from all the whipping around. And then we could roll over again. But it seems like something you pointed out in the past is that stocks like Microsoft, even if they do go down with the market, odds are it's not going to absolutely fall apart, you know, double digit percentage, you know, in an outsized way. So in terms of managing your risk on the downside, could potentially be able to get out without getting hurt too badly.
Yeah. I mean, it was still a 5% loss. It's not nothing. It just means that it's easier to deal with the loss, but it's certainly not a guarantee you won't have losses.
Yeah. Okay. So it's a bit of a quiet week tomorrow. I don't know. I mean, we said that in the past, we thought the Friday after Thanksgiving would be a little quiet, and it ended up not being. So bottom line, Ed, a lot to soak in from this week, perhaps licking of some wounds if there were any new buys or, you know, those false starts, signs of hope for investors with that follow through day. But what should investors be thinking right now as we prepare for battle next week?
Yeah, I think you should definitely be taking much more of a defensive mindset, and really is more of a prove me market again. I know we had a follow through day, but the market clearly is not acting like it's a healthy market. I mean, it's on the edge of failing, quite frankly. I mean, or, you know, so choppy markets chop up investors. And this is dangerous because there's just enough of these moves to lure you in. If this were a market correction, you'd be like, oh, this is bad. I'm going to get out. I can move to the sidelines. That's easier to deal with than this kind of market. So if you feel just tempted, okay, it's one thing to get into some of these sectors that are doing well, but how long will those sectors do well? I don't know. That's just talking about nibbling at those sectors. I really think that you should wait for real strength. And, you know, even then just add exposure slowly. You know, the market breadth is weak. There's been a lot of choppiness, even in this area. And let the market prove itself before you really build up your exposure. And until then, I think you should just be thinking about preparing for the next strong market rather than trying to make a lot of money in a bad market. Mm-hmm. Yeah, force it. Exactly.
Yeah. All right. Well said, Ed. Thanks so much for that. We hope everyone has a great weekend. I will not be here next week, but I will see everyone back on the 27th. So I hope everyone has a very Merry Christmas, happy holidays, and the team will see you right back here next week. Thanks, everyone.